that the Hamiltonian was the free Hamiltonian. First, because only the free Hamiltonian is diagonalized by creation and annihilation operators. And then when we do time evolution to find the Heisenberg operator, only with the free Hamiltonian A and A dagger evolve with simple exponentials. Anyway, so for the theory in which we switch off the interactions, we can write down the Heisenberg field. So we'll denote this, the Heisenberg field of free theory, by a superscript zero to distinguish it from the exact Heisenberg field of the interacting theory. So the idea is that, well, since we have here an explicit formula and we know how to, say, commute these operators, how they act on the ground state, well, I should say on the empty state, we want to formulate everything in terms of free fields. Yes, so this should be multiplied by theta of p of zero. And then the idea is that we compute Gn using free fields. Well, it's clear that G0 can be computed using free fields. It's not quite clear that we can compute higher order corrections using this formula, because in the definition we have Heisenberg fields of the interacting theory. But then there is a way to express interacting field through the free field. So there is a way to do it, and there is a sort of longish derivation of the formula that expresses the green function of interacting fields through the green function of free fields. And they decided not to derive it. So if you want to see how it is derived, you may look up in the textbook or in the notes. So let me just give the final answer. So the answer can be written in a way that's valid to any order of the expansion, though this formula that I'm going to write is a little bit symbolic. So what we do is we, well, replace the interacting fields with free fields, but then add an extra ingredient, which is just the exponential of the interaction Lagrangian expressed again through free fields. So this form also has a denominator. That is just an exponential of so, okay, so how one should understand this formula? Well, so here T time orders fields that stand to the right of it. In particular, time orders everything that appears here in the exponential. So let me try to give an example. So I'd like to stress again that this equation is valid in any quantum mechanical system. So one can define Green's functions for an harmonic oscillator by the same sort of formulas and then express them in this way through the Heisenberg operators of just harmonic oscillators. So it's a general formula. The reason you haven't seen it before is that for an harmonic oscillator is not so, you can do with much easier tools. So how to understand it? Let's consider as an example the case of the two-point function. Let's see what did we have in the numerator. The interaction Hamiltonian is, the interaction Lagrangian is minus lambda over 4 factorial phi to the 4th. So let's see. So the numerator then, to the leading order, it will contain phi of x1, phi of x2. So this is the Green's function of the free fields. And then we just expand the exponential. So it's interaction Lagrangian contains a lambda. So we just expand the exponential function in power series. To the leading order, what we will get is minus I lambda over 4 factorial. But then we will write the integral that appears in the exponential outside of the matrix element. So you see here in this formula, we should time order all 3 points. So we time order x1, x2, and the x. So in this sense, t acts on everything. And well, it is clear that what happens at higher order. So at the second order, we will have 2 integrations. And so on. So this formula should be understood as a formal power series in lambda, where at each order we have a Green's function of free fields, where we integrate over intermediate positions of the interaction, of the fields that come from the interaction Lagrangian. So at the end, what we need to learn, so to be able to calculate the coefficients that appear in this expression, we need to learn how to compute the Green's functions of free fields, and nothing more. Although you see that here, the number of free fields that appears in the matrix element grows with the order of perturbation theory. So so we need only Green's functions of free fields. So in a sense, the science of Green's functions is just that of computing the Green's functions of free fields. So in other words, this formula expresses the Green's functions of interacting fields through the Green's functions of the free fields. And there is sort of a nice way to represent this relationship that goes under the names of Feynman diagrams. So our goal will be to learn how to do computations using this technique of Feynman diagrams. So the first step is to be able to calculate the Green's functions of the free fields. So again, returning a little bit back, the reason to introduce Green functions was partially because this formula is so simple. So for, say, the matrix elements of fields without any ordering, you will not be able to write such a simple equation. It was very important that the fields here were time ordered from the very beginning. So what we want to compute Green's functions of free fields. So we set the interaction Lagrangian to zero. Then there is no distinction between phi zero and phi, so I'll not write the zero, this zero subscript on the field. And then what we want to do is we want to compute the Green's functions that are defined here. So instead of the vacuum now is the empty state. The operator is written here. And we know how our oscillators act on the ground state. We know how they commute. So the problem is purely combinatorial. We just need to take a matrix element of some expression that depends on oscillators. So there is a nice way to do this type of computations. So to illustrate it, let me start with the simplest example of the two-point function. Right, so we need to find the vacuum average of the product of two fields that are ordered according to their time coordinate. So how to do it? Well, what we will get is, in general, a quadratic expression in oscillators. And since, the annihilation operators, they kill the vacuum on the right and the creation kill the vacuum on the left, many terms will just be zero. So to separate the creation and annihilation operators, it is convenient to decompose the field variable into plus and minus parts. So where phi plus minus of x, so this is given by the same expression, but we leave only creation or only annihilation operators. From the definitions, it's clear that phi plus annihilates the empty state. Then phi minus, in fact, it's phi minus is the Hermitian conjugate of phi plus. And so it annihilates the left vacuum. So the second property of these operators is that their commutator is a C number. Yes, so it means that it is not an operator, just a number, right? Because when we commute A and A dagger, what we get is some delta function, but it's a numeric delta function. There are no operator on the right-hand side. And so this will be some function of x and y. So this is, they have some arguments. This will be a function of x and y, but this function will be numeric. Yes. Well, this is how they appear in there.
Because then we have a choice about which thing we label phi plus and which we label phi minus.
Well, I'm just separating this term from that term. Okay, so this I'll call phi plus and this phi minus.
How come the plus is associated with the annihilation operator and the exponential
this is annotation. This is just a way, this is a common notation for this. We could have called this phi 1 and phi 2, but in the textbook they are called phi plus and phi minus.
I thought I already knew something about positive or negative frequency.
Well, frequency is here in the exponent. Well, just let's just look at this formula and don't think about anything else. So it's a definition, okay? So it's phi plus is defined such as to have only A and phi minus to have only A dagger. So then they satisfy these properties and they commute among each other. So phi plus minus commutes with phi plus minus at any point. So these two equations are enough to calculate any matrix element of these operators. Because, well, what we do is we use the commutation relations and which leaves a way which leaves behind only the C numbers to commute phi pluses to the right and phi minuses to the left, right? So until phi plus annihilates the vacuum. So let's see how it works for the two-point function. And hopefully it will be enough to understand the general picture. So So how does it work? So we should distinguish two cases because of the time ordering. Let's consider first the case where x, the time component of x1 is bigger than the time component of x2. Then, well, what we need to compute is phi1, phi2. So let me not write x1, phi of x1, phi of x2, just label them as subscripts. So this will be then is equivalent to this matrix element. So because of time ordering. So then what I do is I expand each of these fields into creation and annihilation operators. Then expand the brackets. So what I'll get, phi1 plus phi2 plus plus phi1 plus phi2 minus plus phi2 phi1 minus phi2 plus plus phi1 minus phi2 minus. So let's see. In this term, phi2 plus stands to the right, so it acts on the ground state and annihilates it. So this term is zero. So in the second term, I have phi minus acting on the ground state, that's not zero, and phi plus acting on the left ground state, it's also not zero, so this term is not zero. Here I have phi plus to the right, so this will be zero. In this term, I have phi minus to the right, that's not zero, but then I also have phi minus acting on the left vacuum, and this will be equal to zero. So I'm left with only one term. And well, what do I do with this term? What I do is I just use the commutation relation. So I write it as the commutator of phi 1 plus phi 2 minus plus the operators in the opposite order. So this now gives zero, and this is a C number. So finally, what I get is simply commutator of phi plus one with phi two minus. Right? Okay, so then we should consider the second case where the time ordering is opposite. Then the time order product of phi1, phi2 is equal to phi2, phi1, which we again expand like we did in this case. So you see that here the only difference is that we relabel one and two. So after all these calculations, we will be left with the commutator of phi two plus phi one minus. So that's the end of the calculation. Well, we found that the answer is either this commutator or that commutator, depending on how we have ordered the fields. Okay? So it is convenient to introduce a special notation for this commutator. This is called weak contraction. Of two fields. And is defined in the following way. So if you have fields phi of x, phi of y, then their weak contraction is defined as phi plus of x commutator phi minus y, if x 0 is larger than y 0, or is commutator of phi plus y, phi minus x, if y 0 is bigger than x 0. This is a C number, so this is some function of x and y, which we'll later compute. So it has some very explicit expression. So the result of these manipulations shows us that the Green's function, or that the two-point Green function of free fields is equal to the weak contraction. Well, then, I mean, as usual in physics, if you have some system, and say this, if you want to compute the Green's function of n operators, you first compute it for n equals 2, then for n equals 3, for n equals 4. Then we see the general pattern and we write the answer. So we'll do the same here. So let's go on and compute the three-point function. Okay, so the claim is that the three-point function is just 0. How to see this? Well, we will have a product of three fields, phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. So the terms that are have a chance to be non-zero will have the, so they will have to have a phi minus field to the right and phi plus field to the left, okay? So there will be also a term phi 1 plus, phi 2 minus, phi 3 minus. So what we do here is that we commute this. And so when we interchange the order of these operators, phi 2 will act on the vacuum and will annihilate it. So this term will be equal to commutator of phi 2 plus phi 3 minus, and then the expectation value of phi 1 plus, but that is 0. And in the second term, we'll have the commutator of phi 1 plus phi 2 minus, and then the expectation value of phi 3 minus. and that's also zero. Yes. Right, so yes, so we consider the case where x1, 0 is larger than x2, 0, larger than x3, 0. And then we will get 0, well, we will get 0 by the simple, because, you know, when we need to, what we need to calculate is the leftover of this commutation procedure, right? So, but if you have an odd number of operators, so we eliminate pairs of them by commuting them, but one operator will be always left. It has no other field to pair with. And then the expectation value of a single field is always zero. So three-point functions will be equal to zero. And actually, the same is true for 2n plus 1-point functions. Okay, so let's now compute the four-point function. So I don't write explicitly the expansion of phi 2, 3, and 4. But the strategy here is clear. So this term, let's see, so the phi minus acts trivially on the left vacuum. So this term is immediately zero. And this phi plus we will need to commute to the right. So we will commute it consecutively through phi 2. So this would produce a commutator of phi 1 plus phi 2 minus, and then the expectation value of phi 3, phi 4, okay? Plus the term in which phi 2, okay, let me write it explicitly, so this will be equal to phi 2. Phi 1 plus phi 3 phi 4. This is equal to phi 1 plus phi 2 minus. And then expectation value of phi 3, phi 4. So here I continue to commute phi 1 to the right. So what I will get is phi 1 plus phi 3 minus expectation value of phi 2, phi 4 plus the commutator of phi 1 plus phi 4 minus expectation value of phi 2, phi 3. And that's it. And we know how to calculate those. This will be again a commutator of phi plus and phi minus. So at the end, we reduce the problem So you see that we pick up all possible commutators between pairs of fields. Now these commutators, so this term would coincide with the Green's function that we want to calculate if the fields are ordered precisely as written here. So if x01 is larger than x02, larger than x03, et cetera. So if they are ordered differently, we should have computed a different product of fields. But this would be obtained by simply relabeling the coordinates here in the commutators. So if you replace a commutator by contraction, then the answer will be written in the uniform way for any ordering. So in other words, what I want to say is that the t-ordered product of four fields is equal to all possible contractions between those fields. So we take contraction of phi 1 with phi 2, phi 3 with phi 4. This originates from this term, plus the next term gives phi 1 contracted with phi 3, and phi 2 contracted with phi 4. Plus phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4, phi 1 contracted with phi 4, and phi 2 contracted with phi 3. So if we now say that contraction of phi x, phi y, well, it will be some function of x and y. In fact, this function is called propagator. So this can be written as sum of all possible propagators. D12, D34, plus D13, D24, plus D14, D23. So what the propagators, so this just tells us that we should compute the propagator of x1 minus x4. So how can we represent this graphically? Well, we can say that we have 4 points in spacetime, x1, x2, x3, and x4. And we connect them by propagators in all possible ways. So we connect x1 and x2, then x3 and x4, plus x1 connected with x3, x2 connected with x4. And then the term in which x1 is connected to x4, and x2 is connected to x3. So in these diagrams, we represent each propagator by a line. Yes? This is an arbitrary way. I mean, it's just combinatorial way to. These pictures represent combinatorics. So these pictures are called Feynman diagrams. And so we can make a general statement now. That goes under the name of the Wicks theorem. So the Wicks theorem tells us that, that the endpoint function of Green of free fields is computed by summing over all possible weak contractions of field operators. Or, if you wish, over all possible Feynman diagrams. So you just, if you have a product of fields, you contract them pairwise in all possible ways. Each contraction is associated to d of x minus y. And so fully contracted expression is just a product of propagators. And then you sum over all possible ways of contracting the field. So it's just a combinatorial problem at the end. Or you can draw these pictures where you have points and lines connecting them pairwise. And then again, to each line, you assign a propagator and multiply all propagators that appear in one particular picture and sum over all possible pictures. So this gives the combinatorial way to compute any Green's function of free fields. So in the next lecture, we will first of all, understand what is this propagator. So we will need to calculate it. It's just as a function. And then we will go in and understand how to calculate Green's functions of interacting fields. So for that, we already have all necessary ingredients. There is this master formula that expresses the Green's function in terms of the Green's functions of free fields. And for free fields, we have this combinatorial method of calculating them. Do you have any questions? Yes. No, it's a general statement. It's valid for any linear combination of creation and annihilation operators. Yes.